My name is Andreas Buchheit. I generalized a 300-year-old formula and unveiled new phases in exotic superconductors using high-performance computers.
Hello, Andreas. Thank you for coming to Erlangen.
Sure, it's a pleasure. Thanks for having me here.
Okay, so can you tell us a little bit about your research?
Sure. So I'm an applied mathematician and theoretical physicist from Saarland University. And what we're doing is we are developing new mathematical methods and we use them to solve with them open problems in physics that are of relevance.
So what kind of physics are we talking about?
So for instance, one thing we are looking at the moment is how we can simulate large numbers of particles that are interacting over large distances with each other. That's super important in a lot of physical systems. For instance, when you want to understand how materials behave.
Can you be a little bit more specific about what kind of materials you're studying?
One material that we are very interested in are superconductors.
Okay, so what's a superconductor?
Well, imagine you have a wire made out of metal and you put a current through it, right? What happens is the wire becomes warm, and at some point, if you put the voltage down, the current dies down. So what happens is you have energy, and this energy dissipates into heat and gets lost. Superconductors, they have the property, they have zero electric resistance. And that means you can transport energy over arbitrary distances and there's no energy loss. There are super many applications. For instance, imagine you want to transport energy from the North Sea down to Bavaria.
Okay, but superconductors exist, right? So why are we not doing that right now?
Well, superconductors, they are known for more than 100 years. Actually, in 1911, Mr. Onnes discovered that if you cool down mercury to almost zero, then it becomes superconducting, suddenly zero resistance. But that's also the big problem. You need to cool down these materials to very, very low temperatures, such that they become superconducting. And that stops them from starting a technological revolution because you always need an expensive cooling system.
Last year, I remember, there was some fuss in the media about superconductors and possible a new possible breakthrough. So what was that all about?
Yeah, so one big goal of all of condensed matter physics is to find a superconductor that does not have this restriction that you need to cool it down a lot. And if you would have such a room temperature superconductor, let's say, that works just here in this very room, then you could have such important technological applications. Imagine not only energy transport to be very, very cheap, you can imagine maglev trains that are operating with superconductors that can create very strong magnetic fields. Or if you look in medicine, there is magnetic resonance tomography. If you have ever done that, the device is really large because there's such a big cooling system involved. If you take the cooling away, you could have a handheld device pretty much. And in Korea, they claimed in summer 2023 that they had found such a room temperature superconductor. The material was called LK99, and they did measurements. They saw it became superconducting at room temperature. But alas, it turned out it was just a fault in the measurement. But still, that shows you how eager the field is trying to achieve this holy grail of condensed matter physics, to find a room temperature superconductor.
When you compute this, for example, transition temperature, what do you actually compute? I mean, the outcome is a prediction about the temperature, but what do you actually compute under the hood?
That's a very good question. So what you're computing is actually a phase diagram. Imagine water. If you take water, it can appear in various different forms of phases. that, as we call them in physics, you can have water as ice if temperature is very low, you can have water just as a liquid, or you can have water vapor if you increase the temperature, it transforms into a gas. So by changing temperature or pressure, for instance, you can go through these different phases of the material that behave completely differently. And it's similar for a superconductor. There you can also change temperature and pressure, especially temperature. As you go down to low temperatures, you find superconducting state. But there's not only one superconducting state. There are different phases that behave in completely different ways. So superconductor is not equal to superconductor.
So these computations of the phase diagram, can you actually do that on your laptop? Or are they very expensive in terms of computation?
With very strong assumptions, you can maybe get a result on your laptop. For more realistic simulations, you need a supercomputer.
Okay, so supercomputing, that's why you're here, actually?
Yeah? Exactly.
So what brought you to using our resources here at NHR at FAU?
Especially for the unconventional superconductors that we do not fully understand yet. We know from experimental data that there are actually long-range interactions in there. And that becomes computationally very expensive, even though we have this new formula at hand if we want to do realistic simulations. And that's why I came into contact with NHR at FAU, because here you have the resources to actually do these computations.
So just for context, you have to apply for compute resources here at our center. So you did that?
Yes. I applied for a test project here.
So test project, that means you could just try stuff out. You could try to run your programs, to port it to the supercomputer, but you could not use a lot of resources. That was not the goal at that stage, right?
Yeah. So the amount of resources was limited. Still, the amount of resources was enough to do interesting calculations, but it was also a lot about, okay, how we can take our code and port it to the system that you're using on the supercomputer and test out whether this system fits our needs.
So did the supercomputer do the job well, or did you encounter any roadblocks?
It did the job super well. That's why we actually applied for a follow-up project here. And what I especially liked was when porting code to supercomputers, you find some obstacles, naturally, and here just helps to be in close contact with people from NHR at FAU, and they could help us a lot with all the porting problems we had, and we were soon ready to go.
Was there any long-term impact of this interaction with the NHR FAU people?
So one thing that happens here when you run your code is it's monitored. So people have a look at how your code runs, and then you get into discussion about how you can improve your code. And during these discussions, actually, we found out that there's a much more efficient way to solve our equation. We're solving there an equation that describes how electrons in a superconductor pair together. And yeah, in this computation, we realized that at some point we could gain a quadratic speedup in our calculations.
So quadratic, that means if a problem is quadratic, usually that means if you double the size of the problem, like the size of a material or your test sample, then the computational effort quadruples, right? That's
exactly.
Quadratic behavior. And that was the case before you came here.
Exactly. And now the behavior became more linear. That means you put n unknowns inside a problem, and you get a runtime that approximately scales as n. And that's almost the best outcome that you can have in a numerical program.
So you said that all programs running on a supercomputer are monitored. Mm-hmm. So in essence, people are snooping on you? Isn't that a little bit annoying, knowing that people look at what you're doing?
At first, obviously, but well, as we've seen, of course, once you get into discussions, it's helpful.
It's a fresh look.
Yeah, you get a fresh look. You talk about what you're doing, and already just by just talking about it, you get new ideas.
All right, so all these optimizations mean that now your program is so fast that you don't need a supercomputer anymore? Is that right?
Well, it's actually possible now to run this program. It takes a bit of time, but you can run it on a standard laptop if you want to. But with these optimizations, we can now do much more interesting things. We can describe materials in much more detail, much more realistic. And then we can take this simulation and put it on the supercomputer again.
So coming back to the actual physics and your research, can you tell us a little bit more about what is it exactly that you found out with your method and how important it is in the general context of superconductor research?
Okay, what I've told you was that we took into account more realistic interactions between electrons. And what we found out is that in this phase diagram, we found actually two phases that we didn't expect at all. That might sound uninteresting. Okay, there are a multitude of phases, there are two new ones, why should we care? But imagine again the comparison to water. Okay, you have the known phases of water, and now imagine you find a phase where water behaves completely in a different way than you would expect. You would say, okay, wow, I didn't know water could do that. And that's the same for these superconductors.
Do they lend themselves, these new phases, do they lend themselves automatically to new interesting applications?
Of course, this is still in the realm of fundamental research, but especially one of these two phases is very, very interesting also for technological applications. One of these phases is topological. Well, what does this mean? Topology, that is like, imagine you have a string and you put a knot in it. Right? And then you can take the string and you can deform it a bit, you can stretch it, you can compress it, but the knot remains. That's topology. So I change things a little, but the general quality remains the same. This means stability. And the stability that topology gives you can be very interesting technologically if you use superconductors for computations. And where can we use them? Well, nowadays there's a big fuss about quantum computers. The problem is that these computers are built out of tiny building blocks, sometimes even just one atom, so-called qubits. And these qubits are very, very error-prone. There comes a photon from the sun, hits the qubit, gone is your information. That makes it very hard to build a quantum computer. And if you could build these tiny building blocks from topologically protected modes that of which we know that they exist in such phases, that would be very interesting because those qubits would be much less error-prone.
So topologically protected means that if you put it on any disturbance on the system, they're much more stable and you don't lose the information.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly. You can disturb the system up to a certain amount, but you still retain the information. Like with the knot, at some point you can destroy it if you put in enough force, but up to that point it's very, very stable.
So what would you describe as the one thing that you found to be great and exciting when you worked with our systems?
Of course, there's not only one thing. I mean, obviously, the hardware was great, the resources were super useful, but what I found really special was the interaction with all of you people from NHR at FAU.
That's actually one of our main selling points, that we don't just run the systems and provide resources for scientists, but also provide people with the appropriate domain knowledge to work with the scientists, to bring their science forward, not just to make the simulations faster, but also to give more context in the context of simulation. For us, it's also great fun to work with people like you and discover new science with you.
It was great fun for me too.
Okay, so thanks for being here.
Thanks for having me.
Hope to see you again.
Sure.